Are you looking to move Microsoft and Oracle workloads into the cloud? I'm Tim Addison from AWS, and today we're going to talk about migrating workloads into AWS. Alongside me, I've got Brian Lebel from Version 1, who are one of our key migration partners. Hi, Brian. Would you like to introduce yourself?
So yeah, as you said, I'm Brian Lebel. I work for Version 1 in our software asset management practice. So we work with customers specifically around optimizing their Oracle and Microsoft license estates. So yeah, thanks for the invite here to chat to you.
No problem at all. Well, let's get straight into it, Brian. And the first question, one that comes up quite a lot, is can you actually run Microsoft and Oracle workloads inside AWS?
Yeah, it's a, like you said, it's a common question, and the simple answer is yes. AWS have been running Oracle and Microsoft workloads for years. You know, one of the first people to do it. So yeah, it's a very simple thing to do. We actually have some follow-on videos to this, which you're speaking to some of my colleagues specifically on Oracle and Microsoft workloads.
And why would customers run workloads inside AWS? What are some of the benefits of doing that?
From my side, obviously the benefits of cloud and of AWS are well documented in terms of the range of services that AWS has and the security and scalability, reliability, all that kind of stuff that people look for when moving away from on-premise. From a licensing perspective, AWS has a number of different options that you can look at with how you bring your licenses, how you use your licenses, and basically how to make the most of them when you're running an AWS. So I think that's one of the key things and why we're kind of discussing this today.
That's great, Brian. Let's say that this is all of interest to me. What would be the recommended next steps?
So this is where our optimization and license assessment comes in. So our OLA service. So what it is, it's where we work with AWS to help customers look at licensing specifically as part of the cloud journey, because it's something we've learned that customers find that licensing can be a very big factor, but often it gets overlooked until more towards the end of the project. So what we do is we put the focus on it from day one, and it looks at what you can do with the licenses that you have right now, what could your potential estate look like in AWS, what the license implications of that would be, and what you need to look at as taking those next steps. So it's a real first step in the kind of cloud journey is to look at what's the impact further down the line, what can we do, and what do we need to kind of investigate going forward.
Well, this sounds great, but how much is it going to cost?
Again, another common question. Well, happily, it's a fully funded exercise, so you, the customer, has no outlay from it from a financial point of view. The other thing that I think is really key to mention on that is that this is a single engagement, so it's not you do this and you have to move to the next step or you have to engage in a cloud migration. This is we're looking at your licensing estate, we're looking at what you can possibly do, and then how that moves forward is completely up to you with no obligation.
Okay, that sounds really good. So what about the length of time to complete an OLA? Is it something that takes months to get through, or is it something that we could do quite quickly?
Yeah, so it tends to be a 2 to 6 week engagement. A lot of that comes down to data gathering. So what we do is we get information from you, the customer, on your estate. So from a technical point of view, what you're running, your license estate. And that exercise tends to be relatively quick because we can use a lot of what's already there. So if you have your own tools, we can use those. If it's declarative data, we can use that. We have external tools that we can use to help. So it's a number of weeks, but it's not a number of weeks that requires your time. It's something that kind of runs in the background.
Yeah.
Once we get the data, we then do all the analysis of it in terms of the licensing side, the technical side of it, and then produce the report on the end of that. So yeah, 2 to 6 weeks tends to be kind of standard timescales for it.
And the other common question I get, Brian, is how much effort is required by the customer to get through this exercise? Because customers don't have a lot of time,
yeah,
and they don't want something that's too invasive of what they're currently doing. Just keeping the lights on can be a challenge. sometimes.
Yeah.
So what's the effort required on behalf of the customer?
So again, minimal effort in terms of the project itself. Once the customer's provided us the initial data, so what the license grant is, what their usage is, from a server side, we then go away and do all the hard work. So there tends to be some back and forth, as you'd expect, because we want to make sure that any assumptions we're making are correct, and we want to make sure that what we're recommending is fit for purpose. So there's some back and forth, but it is just that, it's back and forth. It's not, 3, 5, 10 days worth of your time. So yeah, minimal impact in terms of your day-to-day work.
In terms of the output from the OLA, what does that look like? And how is that going to inform me as to what my next steps are going to be?
Yeah, so it's a single report that's produced at the end of it with all of the data and findings that we have. So it covers a range of topics. So the existing license grant that you have, the existing deployment that you have that we've been looking at, how that could look in an optimized AWS environment from a technical perspective, what the license impact of that is and how we could map your licenses onto that, what other licensing options are available, because as I said at the start, there's a couple of different options available from AWS. So we look at that as well. We also call out anything interesting that we've come across as part of the conversations, because it tends to be quite common that a customer will say to us, we've also noticed this, or we've heard this, that these are the licensing rules or these are the restrictions. So we'll call that out as well, because that can be quite important in getting rid of some of the gray areas that tend to sit around licensing when it comes to moving to the cloud. And then just, kind of any recommendations we have for it. So it's a document that gives the customer the ability to be able to make some decisions on what do we want to do next. It's not the last step in the process, it's the first step, but it allows them to decide, what direction they're going to take.
And, as you've said before, the OLA, it's a well-trodden path. We've literally done hundreds of these just in EMEA,
yeah.
But worldwide it must be running into thousands. So we've got well-documented evidence of what the benefits are. Could you just summarise some of the benefits that customers experience once they've been through an OLA?
Yeah, so there's some documented benefits. So, actual tangible cost reductions, like a 36% reduction in compute costs, a 49% reduction in SQL cores. We've seen that migrations after an OLA take about 28% less time to do. So there's a lot of that side that's very, like I said, documented evidence. I think outside of that, customers really like having the focus on the licensing side, because it's something that the specialists that we have aren't necessarily available to people internally. So having access to those people for a short period of time can be really, really useful, just to, have a conversation about what they're doing, what the impacts are, what we've seen with other customers. So I think there's a lot of very tangible benefits, but I think customers get a lot from the intangible side of it as well.
That's great, Brian. And just in terms of the OLA, there's lots of tools out there that, lots of vendors use to gather information, such as, inventory information, so number of VMs, number of servers, that kind of thing. What makes the OLA unique to AWS and AWS partners?
One of the main things that makes it unique is the fact that it's not a tool. So we at version one, we pride ourselves on the skills of the licensing consultants that we have. And it's that human part of it is what makes the difference, because a tool isn't necessarily always the best for the nuances when it comes to licensing and deployment. So I think that's one of the real key things, is that it's not a tool that runs and we're trusting it to get the right information. It's we take the information from the tools and we apply our knowledge to them, we apply our experience to them. And it's a very, very dedicated licensing engagement. And that's something that we like, and why we're partnering with AWS on it, is because we advocate the fact that licensing is a real important message as part of a cloud journey, and AWS have the same view. So yeah, that's kind of what makes it unique, is that real dedicated focus and using license experts to deliver the service.
Yeah, and I think, you know, from the AWS perspective, we're customer obsessed, we're trying to earn trust with customers, and if we can identify license cost savings in the early stages of the cloud journey, that goes a long way to achieving both of those aims. Yeah. So this sounds all really good stuff. If a customer is interested and wants to get started, how quickly can we engage on an OLA?
Well, if you have the data, we can probably start today. But no, seriously, it's a very, very quick engagement. So from a customer point of view, we need some information on the, you know, the estate that's there so we can agree the suitability of it. Once that's done, it's a, you know, as you said, it's an established, repeatable engagement that we're doing. So it doesn't require a lot of upfront effort to scope it and make sure we know what we're doing and agree the output, yeah, because we all know exactly what that's going to look like from day one. So it's making sure that the environment is suitable for doing it, and then we can normally kick them off, you know, within a number of days in reality.
That's great, Brian. So thanks for talking through the OLA process and the role in version one in helping customers to migrate. So hopefully that's whetted your appetite for the OLA and to work with version one on a migration project. If you want more information, we've got some credits coming up on screen shortly, which will take you to a website that version one have set up. You can also email ola@version1.com for further information. So thanks once again, Brian, for joining me today.
Thanks, Tim.